Good morning, everybody. Welcome to today's 1 million by 1 million strategy roundtable for entrepreneurs. 1M1M, as you know, is the first and only global virtual accelerator in the world. We're headquartered in Silicon Valley, but we operate with a completely global footprint with the mission of helping a million entrepreneurs reach $1 million in annual revenue and beyond, build $1 trillion in global GDP and 10 million jobs. We have been doing these roundtables as one of the flagship events from the program for a long, long time. This is our 276th roundtable. And of course, these are the free public roundtables. We have many more, not just another 275, but many more of these happening inside of our program, the premium program. So we are kind of pros at doing online, you know, mentoring sessions, roundtable mentoring sessions, and have been using this mode to work with entrepreneurs for a long time. And this is a working session, so we're going to spend the first half hour with Pallav Nadhani, but you should line up your questions, and we will get a chance to really have a roundtable discussion later on in the program. Do think of questions, do engage. That's the whole point of a roundtable, right? And it is a working session, so we will be working on some of your projects today. So if you're live tweeting the show, please use hashtag 1M1M. And our Twitter handles are at 1M by 1M and at Romana. And the roundtable recording will be available at 1M1M Roundtables. All prior session recordings are available there, so if you find this program interesting and this is your first visit, you can always go to the channel and look up other sessions. They are very content rich, quite interesting discussions each time. And these are the call-in instructions. Please make a note of the phone numbers. I will put the slide back up when we're ready for call-ins. We're not quite ready right now. We're going to start today with a special guest, Pallav Nadhani, calling in from India, co-founder and CEO of FusionCharts. I have known Pallav for a long time and have admired how he has built his company, and that's what we are going to introduce you to, his journey, his entrepreneurial journey, and what we can learn from that. And, you know, Pallav represents a kind of entrepreneurship that I'm a big fan of, which is more fundamentals-driven, not so speculation-driven. So welcome, Pallav. Thank you for making time to be on the show today.
Thank you, Shamana, for having me. Pleasure to be here.
So, Pallav, let's start with introducing our audience to you and FusionCharts. What have you been up to, and what does FusionCharts do?
Sure. So, FusionCharts, in short, is a data visualization component. We help developers build charts and dashboards, which otherwise they would have had to spend a lot of time building themselves. And essentially, it was not meant to be started as a company, but I was 16 years old. I was trying to look for some pocket money, and I would not be able to go to my dad multiple times a week. So I started coding around a charting application or charting a piece of charting code, which I wrote an article on and published on ASP Today. And that fetched me my first $1,500 just for writing the article. And thereafter, what happened is I got a lot of comments from the readers of the article where they were asking for specific modifications or extensions, and I would do them one by one. And it came to a point where I realized I was doing the same thing over and over again. And I thought, hey, you know what, why not make a product? And that was the genesis of FusionCharts.
Fantastic. So you bootstrapped FusionCharts from when you were about 16, 17 years old, and built it up to a considerable size. Talk to us about that journey of how did you manage to do all this?
Okay, so actually not a lot of thought went in early on. I mean, the first few years, a lot of fun. I was in college and I was working on FusionCharts on the side. So for 3 years, I did not have any employees. Just did everything myself, right, from coding to getting on the sales call, to marketing, to making the website, to providing support. And because I knew that I have to go to college in the morning, I tried to build the business in a very lean way, wherein try to minimize the customer interactions. So whenever a customer would have problems, instead of writing to us, he would first go through our website, through our documentation, which was pretty exhaustive at that point in time for a developer product. We built a whole lot of demos so that they can be self-started. So the whole point was to reduce every friction for the customer so that they would not have to reach to me because I would be in college and I would not be able to reply to them. And once I come back from college, then I'd look at all those emails and till late in the evening I'd be replying to them. And in certain cases, even coding for them for free of cost so that I can get an understanding of how they're using our product or how it is fitted. So there have been cases where I have coded for, let's say, an equivalent value of thousands of dollars to be able to just sell the licenses. But the good part was we never had a consulting arm or a services arm. So the product DNA was right there from the start, and the entire effort of providing free coding was to be able to understand how do people use and what can we do to improve. And then after 3 years, I think, after multiple releases of the product, then I hired my first employee, so to speak, and he was through a friend's reference, through my cousin's reference, actually. He was my cousin's friend, and that was my first employee. We used to work from our bedroom, both of us. Both of us were single and young, so that worked out well again. So the DNA of lean operations was again kicking in there, and we did not get an office. So that happened for about a year, year and a half, and then we wanted to get more people because we were having a lot more customer, a lot more queries. They were asking for a lot more features. So then we went out and bought a garage-style office, so to speak. That was our first office that we purchased. And I kid you not, we purchased about 1,000 square feet office for less than $20,000 back then in Calcutta. And we spent...
What year was this?
This was 2004 end.
2004,
yeah,
okay.
The latter part of it, right? And then we spent a considerable more amount trying to redo and make it look cool with the branding and the colors that we had. So it was in one of those residential buildings, the ground floor. From the outside, a nondescript building, but the moment you walk in, it will at least look like a space to work, a good space to work out, say. And then we started hiring more people. At that point in time, I had no idea about what hiring means, how to even talk to people, how to conduct interviews, because I'd never worked for anybody in my entire life. So I still remember one incident where we called a guy, the first hire that we wanted to do. They'd come to the office. It was only me and the other guy working in office, and he had gone out for a break, the other guy. So this guy comes in, and I'm just in my normal casual clothes. I go open the door, and I ask him to sit just next to the entrance. And he's looking around. It's all empty. He's slightly confused as to why he's been called here. And then when I asked him to follow me for the interview, his first question was, are you going to take my interview? He was kind of baffled that the guy who opened the door is going to take his interview and who doesn't look like the one kind of is the, let's say, the person behind it. Needless to say, he didn't join, but it was a good eye-opening experience in terms of understanding how to deal with people's psyche. And then eventually, over the next year or so, we built a team of around 20 people in Calcutta. And most of them were, like, either it was their first job or they were straight out of college, because Calcutta is not exactly known for its product-centric development. It's mostly a services city.
Or startup.
So, now it has changed, but this was back in 2005, early, right? And so we had to groom each of these guys, spend a whole lot of time with them, help them understand how to even think about products, build products, pay attention to detail, help them with the communications, like the very basics of it. So those were fun days because it was more like a family than a team. We would help each other. There were no HR policies, by the way. People would take leaves when they want. They would come when they want, go when they want. And the only focus was, you know what, let's make great products. And at that point in time, we were growing like anything over 100% over year on year. And we, like the only interesting problem we had was, hey, how do we deal with so many customers? And how do we deal with all the requests that are coming in on, hey, make this thing, make that thing, like a barrage of feature requests, a barrage of product ideas. So we kept on getting people. At 20, we capped out on that office space. And also at that point in time, so because most of my college time in the graduation was spent building this product, so I wanted to go out and actually do further education while still running FusionCharts. So I made a conscious choice to go to UK, University of Edinburgh, about a year, stayed there while about 20 members were working for me here. I'd fly down once a quarter, spend a week with my team while I was pursuing my education there. That was more just a personal goal. And even in that time, we did multiple releases, added new product lines, and the team here was very supportive, and they were able to pull it off. And then once we came back in 2008, then again we started hiring, and we literally cramped for office space. So 2009, we moved out to another bigger office space. But between 2005 and 2009, from one product, we grew to four products. From about, in 2005, I would say it was about 3,000 to 4,000 customers, we grew to about 12,000 customers. And then we had to set up different teams, and we had to set some processes. I remember at one point in a time, this was early 2009, we had about 45 people in the team, and all 45 were directly reporting into us, into me, because I had no idea how to set organizational processes, so on and so forth. So 2009 and 10 was where we...
So Pallav, before we go beyond 2009-10, help kind of pin this journey with revenues. So you did all this revenue finance, right? It's all, you didn't raise any money, nothing. So help demarcate the revenue line along with this journey that you described so far. Bring us up to 2009-10.
Okay, let me just pull up the numbers. I don't remember that. But yeah, so the first year, 2002, from like October when we launched till March, we made about $10,000. 2003, we had about $100,000 in revenue. 2004 was about $300,000. 2005 was about $750,000. And then 2006, I think we did about $1.5 million. And after that, it went about $2 million, then $2.8 million in 2009. So these are approximations. I don't remember from the top of my mind the later years, but on the same growth curve that I just talked about.
And then, so let's carry on. After 2009, what happened? You had a lot more people, 12,000 customers.
Yeah. So till 2010, about 80, also more than 80% of the code shipped was personally written by me, hand coded by me, and with 40 people reporting into me and all these customers. I was practically not getting any time to code myself, so I had to figure out means to be able to replace myself, what we now call effective delegation. So we started making teams, making team owners, started setting policies and structures for this. And again, because at that point in time, the ecosystem was not so developed, there was nobody to look up to or even go and talk to, and most of you were in Calcutta. I mean, if we had been in Bangalore or let's say Silicon Valley, we had ready support available. So there we had to actually do everything ourselves, experiment and fail. So 2009 and 2010, there was a lot of organizational building, not just product, not product building from my side, obviously teams were building products. And we again added two more product lines. So till 2009, we only had products for developers. 2009 and 10, we added products for business users because we saw a lot of business users coming to our website. And they said, hey, we love your charts. We want to use it in PowerPoint. We want to use it in SharePoint. We want to use it in FileMaker. Think of any business application. So we set up different teams to make all those products. So there was a span from four products. In 2 years, we went to 16 products in 2009 and 10. And most of them were revenue generating, but not large enough. So some of these products we later covered, and I'll come to that, that was in 2013. But at that point in time, the focus was, let's get as many people as we can who can come and just push the pedal, because there was so much demand, and we're pretty much at the top of the curve in that market, the data visualization market, the tools market, and the components market. So 2010, then we hit a bottleneck in terms of, we've got all the people in Calcutta who we know who are smart enough to be hired, and the rest of them would, even if we bring them, it would take us about a year or two to shape them up. And because we are moving at that moment and at that point in time, we did not have the luxury of time. So then we decided, hey, you know what, if city is a restriction, if Calcutta is a restriction, why not look at another city? So we, in 2011, we started a Bangalore office, which is pretty much the Silicon Valley of India, and got a whole lot of people here who have been there, done that, returned from Silicon Valley, built companies and sold them. So we came in here, started building the management layer. We hired a head of ops, a VP engineering, a VP sales, a VP marketing. So those went well for the next couple of years. All our products started monetizing well. And then in 2013, we came to a point where we had way too many products to be handled for a team of about, I think at that point, about 75 odd people. So we made a conscious choice saying that let's cull some of the product lines which are not generating enough revenue and which are still satisfying a small section of the users, and let's go back to the basics and solve the larger problems or solve problems of the largest cohort of our customers. So from 16, we went back to 5 products. And then again, we incubated one new team to be able to build another product on dashboards. So here we are trying out a different model. So till 2013, everybody who was working in FusionCharts was a member, an employee, so to speak. So 2013, I started incubating companies internally where members would come and I would be having a co-founder with significant equity stake, and both of us would build the companies together within the banner of FusionCharts. So tried a couple of them, built a couple of products, got some revenues for both of them. But again, those did not shape up large enough. So again, we culled them. Again, then we went back to five products, and that is what we are now continuing with. So this has been the journey.
What's the revenue level today?
So last year we closed about $8 million in top line, $8 million.
Okay. And talk to me a bit about how you did all this customer acquisition, 12,000 customers, 15,000 customers. This is all very, large numbers of customers, and you're doing that sitting first in Calcutta for many years and then Calcutta and Bangalore. But you're doing it all from India, global customer base. How do you acquire customers?
Right. So in short, we are marketing fueled and inside sales fulfilled. So right from day one, again, this goes back to the college days where I knew that as a 19-year-old, if I call somebody, I would not be able to make a sale. Plus, we have the time difference, so we had to devise ways of the product selling itself or the product marketing itself. So we did a whole lot of content marketing to start with. There have been incidents where we wrote articles for websites promoting our product in interesting ways, and we got paid back for our own marketing because they used to pay their authors. So instead of us paying for our marketing, we got paid back. Then we wrote. So one of the things which we did was make it very, very frictionless for anybody to come and adopt our product. So we had to make our website very, very good so that when people come there, it's not just marketing speak, but they can see the use cases. They can go from zero to one within 15 minutes. And we even had a money back guarantee that if they cannot build a chart using our product in the first 15 minutes, we'll give them their money back and they get the license for free. Until date, nobody has claimed that refund. So no frictions, great documentation, great demos, and then content around that, which helped people understand what is the use case. And also one of the benefits we had is because we created this category and the web was also evolving, where it was a better way to visualize data, more engaging, more animated, interactive. So the word spread itself, and we enabled our users to be able to tell others, which we also helped them by giving them referral bonuses of sorts, giving them additional support packages, or just by generally having a good relationship. So wrote a lot of articles. Our customers wrote a lot of articles or blog posts. A lot of our customers built products around our products and they open sourced it. So for a lot of other technologies where they want to integrate our charts, let's say WordPress or Python, so on and so forth. So a lot of our customer communities made these products for free and they were popularizing these products. So every time they popularized those products, our name would come up as part of it. And then when Google AdWords started, this was, I think, about 2005 or 6. So one of the first customers of Google AdWords, and those times, the bids were very, very low. I remember 2 cents a click and so on and so forth, which has gone astronomically high right now. Then we used a lot of listing sites back then. These were like developer listing websites. We would actually help them shape the content, so it's not just plain advertisement. So whenever we did content, we were always thinking, hey, can we not make it look like advertisement, but can we make it look like an informative article which has real value to the user? In our case, the user is the developer. So he was always consuming something interesting, and we were a part of that article either as a chart, graph, a sponsor, or even as a co-author of that article. So that worked out well, and we got that's a good karma points in the developer community.
So, folks, those who are listening to this call, please make a note of the content marketing emphasis. Content marketing has become a very important tool for marketing. And so the timeline that Pallav is describing of the last 11 years, this has become more and more important. You know, today, it's one of the most effective ways of actually marketing your products. And especially if you may have something that lends itself well to content marketing, please do consider that as a key strategy for customer acquisition. So, Pallav, let's switch the topic of discussion a little bit. I want to hear from you what your thoughts are as well as experiences as far as outside capital is concerned. You're sitting in Bangalore now. India, you know, I was thinking a few years ago when I wrote the Seed India book, I was thinking that India was going to develop, you know, the startup ecosystem of India was going to develop with a more fundamentals-driven approach. Indians tend to be less, at least at that time, the Indian ecosystem was much less risk-prone, much more fundamentals-oriented. But unfortunately, that has changed. So India has gone wild and crazy and kind of irrational as well. So stupid amounts, stupid valuations, stupid amounts of money going into companies without the TAM, without the market size, without the growth rate, without, you know, revenue lines, all of that craziness is happening in India as well. You actually have a fundamentals-oriented, solid business. And of course, you've grown slower than a venture timeline would expect or assume, but given where you are today, given the kind of customer base you have, I wonder if you wanted to raise venture capital and go faster, could you do that? Is that an option? I'm sure VCs are wanting to talk to you about this and so forth. So talk to us about what your thinking has been on this topic.
Right. So in, I think it was about in 2009 and 2010, we actually flirted with a few VCs, but it came to our, I mean, we dawned upon the realization that just money cannot push us ahead. And by that time, we had enough money in our bank from our cash flows that it did not make any sense for us to take money from VCs. And we are already partly investing that in new products, new teams, more of better sales and marketing, especially when we are building very, very IP-centric company because we are building products which sell on merit to developers across the world. So, for example, we have a photo of President Barack Obama using our product, and we had no idea that the U.S. government is using our product. We just went, I just went out one night partying. Next morning, I come up, I see, hey, there's a President Barack Obama, there's a photo of President Barack Obama using our product, and it's on the White House blog. So the entire product is being sold on merit, and we already have enough cash in the bank to be able to fund product development, to be able to augment it, spawn multiple products. So it's not just the capital which is going to help us propel ahead. So we made a conscious call not to take capital, and we've been fortunate enough to have good gross margins, and which we are kind of reinvesting in other businesses, and even then we have healthy margins after that. So as of now, unless the capital comes with really, really great value, which today we do not possibly, which we are not leveraging today, I don't think just plain capital is effective enough.
So I actually have also a philosophical question that I have thought about for a long time, which is one of the impetuses for me to start 1 million by 1 million, is that growth, you know, obsessive pursuit of growth is not necessary, actually. This is, you know, what I'm saying here is blasphemy in Silicon Valley. So this is not the point of view at all here. Somebody is talking in the middle of the call. You need to put yourself on mute. Maureen, can you put this other person on mute, whoever is interrupting the call? All right, so what bothers me is that in the pursuit of growth, entrepreneurs are trading off a lot of the core values of how to build great companies. And some things just take time. So if you try to force growth in a way that is unhealthy, I don't think you build great companies. What do you think, Pallav?
So I think you're bang on with this. So I think growth is good, but it has to be healthy and sustainable growth. It should not be at the cost of the customers or cost of the culture of the company or anything which is going to come and haunt you back at a later stage in life, be it unhealthy valuations, be it trying to sell shelfware to customers just in an effort to boost this year's revenue. So at the end of the day, the intersection of customers, employee, and the entrepreneur, all of these, the success metric of all of these three cohorts have to be the same. And if the growth is driving this success metric without creating anything unhealthy, so I'm all in for that growth. But if it's pushed too far at the cost of any of this, then I don't believe in that as well.
And what are your thoughts about exit? So, you know, in Silicon Valley, of course, everybody thinks about valuation and exit way before, you know, revenues and profits and fundamentals. And unfortunately, that disease has now trickled into India as well. The recent, you know, craze around valuation and exit and all this, you know, fundraising valuation, unicorn valuation has become quite crazy. What are your thoughts about exit?
So we have also been enticed by a couple of offers. I mean, we're still independent, we're still working, and we have a long-term plan of to keep building this company. And the question which you kept on asking here was, the most difficult part to build a company is the 0 to 1 stage. And given the fact that what we have built, be it our customers, be it our brand, be it our members, And with the cash in the bank, we have the opportunity to build multiple products, multiple companies under this portfolio that we have. So why exit and go back to stage zero at this point in time? So obviously, our profitability allows us to do all of this. There's no gun to our head because it's 100% privately owned with some of the shares with employees in the future as well. So there's no gun to our head, as I said, that we have to get an exit in the next 5 years, 10 years. We're enjoying what you're doing. Our team members are learning. Our customers are happy. So why even think about an exit? That's the way we're looking at it. The question we ask is, if we continue doing what we are doing, if we continue building products, whether it succeed or fail, and we keep learning, and if this is so interesting, why should we not do it for the next 50 years?
Great. So switching gears again, you started this company in Calcutta. Now, as you know, I have a soft spot for Calcutta because that's where I'm from. And I actually started one of the first product companies out of Calcutta a long time ago, way before you. But it was a very different time. At that time, you know, getting a telephone line used to take 18 months, a landline.
Was I born even then? Was I even
1994, you tell me whether you were born or not. But you were very young. I'm tremendously happy to see that you have succeeded, at least even though you have moved to Bangalore, part of your operation, that at least you succeeded to a large degree working out of Calcutta. Talk to us a little bit about both the pros and the cons of Calcutta. Of course, you know, this layers on the fact that you were young and you were just learning all this, you know, kind of feeling your way around, but you did it in Calcutta, and I'm curious to hear what your experience was.
So even now, a bulk of our team is in Calcutta. In fact, I would attribute most of the success of FusionCharts to Calcutta because that is where we were till 2010, and most of the important portions were developed, or at least majority of the important portions were developed till there. So there are some inherent benefits to staying in Calcutta. One is the froth, the noise does not affect you because there's mm-hmm. no noise in Calcutta. So you keep calm and you build your products and build your company. The city is very, very fundamental business-centric. So they're very, very bottom line centric. If there's no bottom line, they don't understand the business. So the DNA percolates to software company as well. So we have this Marwari community, which I'm sure you know there. It's a very, very business centric community. So those fundamentals are very good. Plus, if you are a good company there, if you're a product company, so the good part is that as a product company, you don't need hundreds of employees. Maybe you need 10, 4, 5, 10 to start up with, expand to 20, 30, 40, 50. And in the initial days, if you do things right, you'll be able to create future product people. So because in the initial days, you might not be looking for the momentum. You're starting maybe a couple of co-founders and you know 3-4 guys. So first 5 guys, create another 5 guys and so on and so forth. That keeps on percolating. And you will be able to get fresh guys, freshers, and help them become successful product guys. And there will not be much attrition. So, I mean, in FusionCharts Calcutta office, we have guys who have completed 10 years. There are many guys who have completed 6 years, 7 years, and they've been very, very loyal to our company and they've been a part of it and they've been learning and they're very happy with it. So you're cut out from that noise. There's not a lot of poaching. It's a very business-centric community. It is a nice, I would say, the city has a very nice vibe to it. The weather is not supportive, though. I mean, it gets really hot. But if you have to aggressively expand, that is where Calcutta might not be a good option. So if your product needs to go from 20 people to 100 people, and I'm talking about product people and not just not support and ops, which is, again, great in Calcutta. If you want to build support and ops teams, it's kind of cheap, and you get a lot of people. Most are well-educated. All of them speak very good English, so all of that is good. But if you want to go from 20 to 100 product people, then that's a problem. If you want to get a product manager who's been there, done that experience, then you might not get it. If you want to get a digital marketer, again, that's going to be a tough find. So we still are looking at opportunities where people who have moved out of Calcutta and are looking to return to Calcutta, if they are interested, we are tapping into that network so that they get the benefit of hometown plus working for a global product company. So the pros and cons are there, as I mentioned.
And is that a big community of people who are wanting to return to Calcutta?
So we have not found a lot of them, but now that's starting to happen. But again, the government has to be conducive. As of now, there's still some turmoil in terms of the business and the product. So as of now, there's still more, drain happening of companies from Calcutta moving out than people moving back in. But we're still waiting and watching.
And what has been your experience moving to Bangalore, moving portion of the operation to Bangalore?
So before the foggy market started, it was amazing. I mean, you have access to such a great talent pool. People are more, the work ethic here is better than what is in Calcutta. More because of the exposure, not something which is intentional, but because of the exposure that they have. Plus you get senior management, people who've been there, done that. And obviously the weather, you can't complain about Bangalore weather, probably the best in India. But in the last couple of years, yeah, it's been a challenge to find, people who can come and directly start contributing, because most of the smart people are now building their own companies. So the number of companies which have been spawned in the last couple of years is huge. So all the smart people are building their own companies, and every other company, whoever is coming from outside India or even from Delhi and Bombay, they're relocating to Bangalore. So there's a huge, huge supply crunch.
Talent
of the good product people.
Good. Well, Pallav, let's start working with the entrepreneurs a bit. I heard that you're going to stay for a little while. Yeah?
Sure. Yes.
Okay. So we're going to start with Stephen Asherman in New York City. Steve, please come unmute yourself and tell us what you're working on.
My name is Steve Asherman. I'm president and founder of Content Galaxy. And are you going to put up slides, or should I just?
Yes. Right here.
Hang on 1 second. Let me just rearrange things so I can see properly. Okay. Can I have the next slide, please? We've developed a better way to buy and sell digital content, especially instructional competition and news videos. So Content Galaxy is a platform for creating paid subscription video channels. We make streaming profitable by pooling related content into flat price channels and paying providers, editors, and affiliates based on metered subscriber usage. Next slide, please. Magazine, newspaper, instructional video revenue has been in a free fall because of users switching to internet-based content. Publishers have yet to come up with a good way to monetize the online content and make up for those losses. Next slide, please. Our publishing platform makes it easy for producers and aggregators of expert, artistic, and event videos, for example, to make money by streaming to their web audiences. Content Galaxy enables publishers to combine independently created videos from multiple sources and build large channels that are both affordable and profitable. To do this, we've built a new kind of hosting service. It's designed to help publishers pool related content into well-edited flat-price subscription channels and then pay providers and affiliates based on actual subscriber usage. Next slide, please. Subscribers pay a flat fee to view anything within a channel. Content providers' compensation is calculated daily based on metered subscriber usage. This model of all-you-can-eat subscriptions with rapid crediting of micropayments to content providers makes large-scale micro-commerce and video streaming practical and lucrative. Next slide, please. What we're doing is filling the gaps between Netflix's approach to high-end Hollywood productions, the iTunes item-by-item purchasing model, and YouTube's free ad-sponsored clips. If you've created an instructional video or captured an important event on video, these giants aren't designed to provide you with an effective way to profit from streaming. Netflix and Hulu's all-you-can-eat model requires complex contract negotiations, often involving large upfront payments to content owners. iTunes and Amazon's are giant stores that give you no access to user data or metrics, and consumers must find their way and make a purchasing decision for each item of interest. On YouTube, it's pretty tough to make non-trivial revenues unless you're a smash hit viral video. So unlike Netflix or Hulu, the Content Galaxy model eliminates the need for individually negotiated contracts and upfront payments to content owners, but can still deliver all-you-can-eat channels. And unlike iTunes, Amazon, or YouTube, there is a transparent process, which is critical to promoting the creation of a new ecosystem for buying and selling digital content. Next slide, please. Fundamentally, Content Galaxy is a new kind of publishing platform for a new kind of internet publisher. The system enables publishers to create profitable channels through aggregation of content from many sources without having to maintain any infrastructure of their own. Publishers are central because they are the owners of the channel and the associated subscriber lists. Every item of content goes through some editorial process determined by the publisher before going into the channel. Naturally, publishers who are also content providers receive larger shares of the subscription revenues. Next slide, please.
So question, Steve, you have
a
publisher running the channel, but your assumption is there are multiple content providers providing content for that channel. So the publisher is managing a large portfolio of content providers who then get paid by this utilization-based metered payment. Is that what you're saying?
That's correct.
Okay.
The affiliate compensation mechanism strongly encourages authors and independent websites to promote content Galaxy channels. Besides paying commissions on new subscription sales, a channel provides an ongoing revenue stream based on subscriber usage. Affiliates are getting paid in two ways: once when a subscription is sold and whenever content is viewed from any web page with a link that includes the affiliate's ID. Simple links that play video on multiple devices can be put into any web page, email, or social network posts with no loss of site stickiness. The subscriber feels that the video is just an extension of the web page that embeds it because he's immediately returned to that page after viewing the video. There's no programming, JavaScript, or API to learn. Besides the publishers, most content providers are also affiliates, and this allows for a low-cost marketing strategy. By promoting their own material, they are doing the publisher's job of promoting the entire channel. What can lead to exponential growth is that followers and fans of expert content providers can also be affiliates and profit from promoting their favorite material. Next slide, please. So we launched our first video channel for Tai Chi and martial arts and have embedded it in our website as a proof of concept. We have initial paying subscribers and affiliates and are looking for publishers interested in creating new paid channels, investors who see the potential, and more great content for our sports channel. Our mission is to be a platform that supports the creation of paid channels, not to be publishers ourselves. However, our first video channel is self-published and is focused on the content of experts that I know personally. Subscribers pay $29.95 a year for unlimited viewing. At this point, we're selling 10 to 20 subscriptions per month, so gross sales are in the low thousands per year, with content providers and affiliates receiving about one-third of that. Next slide, please. The software for this platform was developed with the help of senior consultants who worked for me, motivated by stock options, in between paying projects. Now I've retired from designing financial web applications and running a consulting firm. I've concluded that to make Content Galaxy a successful monetization platform, I must either partner with a major corporation or get outside investment. So my questions for you, Sramana, are about potential corporate partners and early stage investors. Next slide.
So let me answer your question. You know, this is not how early stage financing works. You are going to need to show traction to be able to interest investors. You're talking about largely a consumer concept, and there have been plenty of experiments with this kind of subscription models at this point. Some of it has been successful. So if you look at lynda.com, which LinkedIn acquired, it's been a fairly successful model, but Lynda produces its own content. It's not third-party content necessarily. There's another provider. This is all educational content. The other company that is very interesting is Pluralsight, and we had Pluralsight CEO Aaron Sconnert on our forum a few months ago. You can look up there in the interview as well as the case study on our blog online. Pluralsight also has a subscription model. They charge kind of like a all-you-can-eat subscription, just like you're saying, but they charge. They do have a diverse body of content providers, and they have kind of this metered royalty kind of model for paying the people who are actually generating the content. So that's probably the closest to the model that you're talking about, but it's mostly technical training kind of content. And in that field, they have been quite successful. They have, you know, generated significant amount of money. They're valued at a high market cap. So these are, you know, kind of models and case studies that you should study and try to understand. But the truth is, my observation is at this point, if you want somebody to engage with you as an investor, you're going to have to show traction and adoption and validation of your model before people would be willing to do that. Because there's a huge question mark on to what extent can you scale this. And, you know, there is quite a bit going on in this market in different niches and different areas, but you're going to have to, you know, be able to show that you can make a convincing business, venture-style business out of this if you want professional investors to engage. Now, if you choose to get investors that are friends and family investors, that's, you know, for people who are in the early stages who do not have validation, do not have, you know, a lot of understanding of how this is going to play out, the best kind of investors, if you are looking for investors at all, are friends and family investors. Our recommendation, however, is to try to get the validation in a bootstrap mode.
So if you jump ahead to two slides, so this, my real reason for talking was not, I certainly expected you to give me the answer now that I've had a chance to watch some of your shows and understand where you're coming from. I certainly expected your answer on the investor side. And really, I'm at the point where I think that partnering with a major company makes sense. If you go down two slides, this is, so here's a list of companies that are basically selling all-you-can-eat subscriptions. There's Learn Guitar, there's Linda, there's Marcelo Garcia in action. So there's various kinds of training. The issue is that each one can be looked at as a one-off problem where they haven't solved the question of how do I get content from how do I start bootstrap a channel in an inexpensive way, which means that I don't have to have intellectual property rights on all the content that's in my channel, and that I have a way of getting people to market their own content.
Steve, Pluralsight works exactly in the model that you're talking about, and they have cracked it. They have built a significant company using exactly the model that you're talking about, and they have bootstrap.
The notion here is that there is a way of combining content that causes the people who add the content to also market themselves, market that content themselves.
I understand. That's exactly the model that Pluralsight has followed. And the case studies are available. The case study of how Pluralsight went about it is available on our blog. The interview is available earlier in this series. So you'll have, you know, plenty of ways to research how they do it. But they focus on a specific vertical. They focus on technical content. So it's technical education, programming, various kinds of programming languages, various kinds of technology-related disciplines. That's where
Don't they own or get the rights to that content?
And no. Have they got? So, it's a royalty-sharing model.
Okay. I guess what I'm trying to do is to create a model that would allow news in the long run, newspapers to have video associated video channels, and a mechanism where a newspaper, for instance, could, or a magazine, could use its editorial prowess to create practical video channels.
Newspapers don't do that. They will not. I don't think they will ever want to do it. You know, you have to understand the company's DNA. A company is not going to go so far out of their DNA to do something that is completely outside of their, you know, core competency. Let me ask Pallav what he thinks of your presentation. Pallav, please weigh in.
Sure. So I had a couple of questions here, Stephen. So one is, you talked about publishers already having these videos in DVD. Have you asked them why they did not publish them online? Like, publishing videos is very easy right now. There are enough and more tools, and they already have the distributions and users. What stopped them in the first place to publish it online, given all that technology is free and available. And the second question, or second more, like actually a note is, so for example, if you look at all these sites, so Lind approval site, the intent of the consumer is clear. They go there to learn. This is this, when they go to YouTube, it's a very broad horizontal, let's say, it could be entertainment, could be education, but YouTube, because it was the first site, people know that as a brand. So when you're building a video site, especially for a consumer, what is that one reason or one strong incentive for the consumer to come to a site like that? So if it's education, we have proven models. If it's generic, YouTube has already captured the world. If you're trying to build another horizontal, that's going to be a massive effort in terms of training the consumers in this case, because they're so used to YouTube. And one of the reasons why YouTube was so effective was because you could embed those videos and virality is built into it. In your case, because you have a Chinese firewall around it, because you want to license it, so the virality for the consumers won't come in. So if you can please help me understand both of them as to why the publishers did not do it themselves, and B, what would be the main intent, the main feeling or intention with which the consumers would come to your site?
So I think I have the best way I can answer the question about YouTube is it doesn't satisfy the needs of the content providers. And that's the real problem. So it satisfies the needs of some types of content providers, but not others. And so if you are in the instructional video, if you have instructional DVDs, you're going to be very reluctant to put that material out because the advertising revenues are so slight and trivial. So part of the answer to that has been, well, stop worrying about making money from your content and start worrying about making money from your lessons or the musician from your T-shirts. So it doesn't really satisfy the need of people who are creating content. And so some content providers are taken care of by the current models, and some content providers really aren't. And so that's a very large segment, and that segment is basically instructional especially. If you look at educational videos, that educational websites, those are basically funded from schools, from the government, from universities. And so if the material is school and educational material, then you can see those sites eventually coming up with a monetization model that works and isn't, in effect, banking on the past. Whereas if you want to learn to play guitar, if you want to learn to be a musician, if you want to learn how to do certain kinds of sports, if you want to capture the video that people have on cameras, but they are just not going to be bothered uploading it to YouTube, or the kinds of videos that people used to make for DVDs but now can't play on those devices and can't be protected on YouTube, then that's the market that I think is especially not served now, that needs to be served.
So, Pallav, I think what Steve is pointing out is actually interesting in that the subscription-based learning, you know, in different domains, whether it's learning to play the guitar or learning to program in Python, this is becoming an acceptable model for content consumption. The monthly subscription fees are low, and they tend to be all you can eat. And I think what he's pointing out is exactly what the premise on which Pluralsight has been successful is, that you can bring in a lot of content providers who want to monetize their content by creating some sort of a micro payment royalty sharing model. So that part is, I think, reasonable, and I think it is going to have to be in that educational space. But the truth is, there are a lot of people trying to do this at this point. And unless you can show traction, I don't think either investment or partnership of any kind is viable, Steve.
Okay, so so one more point. So with Pluralsight or Lynda, they curate and they validate the content. So when somebody's paying to the platform, they're getting very high-quality content because of the curation process. Whereas in a marketplace model, where you're just allowing people to upload the content, but you are taking money as a platform, if the video is not good, if the content quality is not good because
you do not have
a curation process.
I think Steve is saying that he will curate, right, Steve?
Well, if you go back up two slides.
We don't need to go back up. We don't have time to go back up.
So basically the idea is that all parties must be satisfied in this process. And so curation, organizing the video content, description of video content, going after people who have video content is a job in and of itself, and that's what I call the editors. And editors also should be able to make a piece of the action, in effect, based on the popularity of the material that they bring in to the publisher. And so that way, you've got a way of motivating everybody involved in creating a great channel. So that means the editing side of this, both in what I call primary editors and senior editors, where senior editors bring an approach, are in effect responsible for supervising the editorial staff. How do you start a channel that isn't going to be outrageously expensive to build without, in effect, giving everybody a piece of the pie in a way that's transparent? So my background is building and designing financial systems, and what this really allows you to do is have a bunch of disparate parties who don't have to trust each other be able to actually understand what's going on and get a revenue piece and have that as a practical way of building a great channel.
Right. So, Steve, we're coming to the end of the time that we had for you. If you could really closely study Pluralsight, I think you will find a lot of resonance and a lot of learning in that story. That's how they have built the company. However, it is a bootstrap company. By the time they raised money, they were already doing $12 million a year in revenue and really fleshed out the model and proved out the model before investors actually were interested in getting involved there. So that's just the reality. There are other people who have tried to do it, have not succeeded in doing it as well. You know, Udacity, some of that Coursera Udacity model kicks in gear as well that has not been successful. Udemy tried to do something similar, but is not as successful as a Pluralsight or Lynda.com. Lynda.com actually produces their own content as well. So I think you have some comparables, some evidence of success, but you're going to need to figure out how you bootstrap, and maybe the way to do it is pick, you know, one or two areas where you do have contacts and network and so forth, and create some successful channels so that monetize well and so forth, and go do it subject by subject.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay, Leah, you're up next.
Sorry, I'll have to sign up at this point. I have an engagement, but it was great being on this.
Thank you for coming, Pallav. It was great talking to you.
Absolute pleasure. Goodbye.
Bye. Leah, you're up next.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Great. Thank you so much. Hi, my name is Leah Keller, and I really appreciate this forum and the opportunity that you've created for young entrepreneurs who are just trying to figure all this out. I'm the CEO and co-founder of the DM Method. And go ahead to the next slide. The DM Method grew out of my private training practice in New York City, primarily going to private clients in their homes, mothers who've just had babies or who are pregnant and expecting. And it really grew like wildfire through word of mouth because the techniques that I use are very unique and they work to both prepare the body for a faster, better labor, and they also get the woman's body back in shape afterwards. So the company, the DM Method, now exists, it's in revenue, and it is a lifestyle brand for moms and moms-to-be, and we have unparalleled medical endorsement, not only from doctors who are raving about the results, but also a study that Cornell conducted of my clients proves that it works to resolve core strength issues and to reverse the mommy pooch. Next slide, please. This is a huge market in terms of extending. So as I said, it grew out of a private training practice, but we now have a website, thedmmethod.com, and we have 18 videos, a complete 9 DVD set, and of prenatal and 9 DVDs of postnatal, and it's also all available streaming, which is interesting given the previous presentation. Currently, our streaming subscription is only through our website, and it's at a fairly premium price. You pay $59.95, but that's for 9 months of access. So it's kind of a higher barrier to entry, but then once you're in, you're there for the whole pregnancy or for a length of time after. The market that we're targeting is a very strong market. This is just with the, including America, and we are selling globally, but within America, there are 18.9 million mothers, aged 25 to 45, who are either pregnant or mothers of children aged 0 to 4. And that segment is spending a lot of money on their bodies and on fitness and health. So there is about almost $6 billion in that market. Those women are looking for safe, efficient, and effective workouts to be fit during pregnancy and to return to pre-baby shape. Go ahead to the next slide, please. The problem right now is that on the market, there are not great alternatives. There are plenty of fitness programs, but they have core strengthening exercises that tend to cause more harm than good for women during this critical phase physically. And there are also a couple of programs that address diastasis recti, which is the primary issue that I address throughout my fitness system, but they're very rigid and they almost scare women that they can't be physical or they can't be fit in other ways. So right now, as I mentioned, we have 9 DVDs that are in the prenatal series called Belly Guard, 9 DVDs in the postnatal, which is also available streaming. Next slide, please. Our competitive advantage, the study that Cornell conducted and published, they also presented it at the annual meeting in 2014 for obstetricians and gynecologists, it proves that it works in 10 minutes a day. So busy moms need something that is going to work and they don't have time to go to the gym for 2 hours. They need something that will actually improve their body in a very, very brief snippet of time. It's also very easy. Once you understand the basic technique, it's very easy to be consistent with that and to see results. The study that Cornell conducted proved that my techniques work in less than 12 weeks to fully resolve the core issues. Next slide, please. And we are currently the only comprehensive total body fitness system that's endorsed by OBs and backed by published medical research. None of our competitors have all of those in one place. And right now, our model is, and this is great, let's stay on this slide. Right now, our model is B2C. We're just directly selling to consumers. And we have traction there. We're right on target to go over $100,000 in revenues this year. Let's back up one slide, please. But there's so much potential in growing the company on a B2B side with health sector contracts. I gave a lecture at NYU, a grand rounds lecture at NYU to their OBGYN faculty earlier this year, and that previous slide about the medical benefits of exercise during pregnancy was so impressive to them, particularly the two things that I highlighted, the 33% decrease in duration of active labor. So if you think about scaling that across a hospital ward, if all of their women who are delivering in a vaginal delivery spend a third less time in active labor, think of all the time that saves for the doctors and the medical staff. And then 75% decrease in the need for operative intervention. And this is all, I can send you all the data, it's all documented and published. But a 75% decrease in the need for either a cesarean or forceps delivery. That is huge. And when we think about payers in the health sector, such as HMOs, et cetera, if they could save, you know, instead of paying $27,000 for a high-end C-section with all the medical stuff that goes along with that versus $1,800 for a natural labor in a birth center, you know, this is very interesting to health sector payers. Go ahead to the next slide. Please. Thank you. So at this point, having gained some traction in the B2C area, we are ready to, and I've assembled an amazing team that includes a lot of experience in pharmaceutical sales and in partnering with health industry players. We are ready to move forward and to really push gaining partnerships and relationships with healthcare providers, healthcare payers, even benefits, like corporate benefits providers. I don't know if you've noticed in the news, like Netflix recently announced a phenomenal maternity package in terms of paid leave, and then Microsoft had to like get in the and improve their policy. There's a lot going on, especially in Silicon Valley, of trying to make their employment more appealing and flexible for women employers. And I think we can also we have some ability to negotiate there, just getting people to have more progressive maternity benefits and offering our streaming subscription and certified instructors, which I'll get to in a second, as a very interesting hip benefit for those employees. Next slide, please.
So let me comment on what you said. I like what you're doing. I think it's one of the, and especially in the context of the previous discussion, I think something that is more contextual, that is specific to a particular audience, where you grow the audience with a subscription and you develop content and stream content to them and sell content to them in various ways, whether it's DVD or streaming and whatever, is the same kind of Netflix type of model. That I buy into that, and I think this is a very specialized offering that you're talking about, although the market is quite crowded, because all the differentiators that you're talking about, you're still going to have to communicate those differentiators to a large audience that is in a very is encountering a very noisy marketplace, right? There are your competitors are also trying to market to them, and you are trying to market to them, and it's not easy for the on the receiving end as a consumer to be able to distinguish between which one is which and which one they should be going for. So that kind of a marketplace is very difficult, actually. Noisy marketplaces are very difficult to differentiate in. So that being said, I guess the part that I don't resonate with is that employers are going to be, selling exercise video subscriptions to their employees. I just don't see that happening.
Yeah.
So I think that is going to be a wasted of your time. The question more is whether OBGYNs are willing to recommend that your methodology, if that's an area where you're getting traction and people actually buy into what you're doing and so forth, that may be a more reasonable path in terms of influencer marketing than corporations.
Yeah, and we have a lot of OBs and midwives who are currently recommending our products, and they offer like a 20% discount to their patients, and we get a lot of customers through them.
I think the more reasonable channel.
Yeah, that's good feedback. Our current thought with the corporate side, which we haven't pursued yet, is to make it a free trial as like an added part of the benefit for their employees.
I wouldn't worry about it. I don't think HR departments will do that. That's just not what they do.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's good. You're helping streamline our process. Thank
you. And wasting time chasing, going on a wild goose chase just is not productive. So I wouldn't recommend you do that.
Okay.
Now, you said you have 2,000 existing customers paying this, what, $59 a month? Is the price?
No, it's $59.95. So we're about to switch our model. Currently, you pay $59.95 for a 9-month subscription, and it's 9 months in part because pregnancy is 9 months, and so it comes out to about $10 a month. Or excuse me, discount off of that.
Got it.
So that's our current model, but we're about to transition. We're streamlining our website to make it a quicker path to buy, and we're also going to be offering both a limited free trial, and that will extend into like $12.95 monthly subscription. So, and we're also selling DVDs, the deluxe DVD package with all the discs and the resistance band and a nutrition guide, et cetera, for $89.95 per item. Can we go back just 1 second, please, for this slide?
You're running out of time. I have to work with one more entrepreneur today, so I'd rather get to your questions.
Okay. So the final thing I just want to explain is that our plan to grow the company is certification-based, which will really support all of our other B2B efforts. Zumba is a prime example that has really been phenomenally successful in the fitness space, and they started listening to their customers who are asking to be certified so they can instruct in Zumba, and that's something that people have been asking me for years. And what is the brilliant thing is that these certified instructors, they pay to get certified, they pay a monthly thing to be supported and get more choreography and that sort of thing, but then they become these ambassadors that build brand awareness, they build enthusiasm, and they get other people who say, maybe I'm going to this class once a week to learn these techniques, but I want to do it at home, so I'll get the subscription too. So it's a way to kind of have a very lean, in terms of our sales force, market that's both bringing us direct revenue, but also growing our revenue prospects.
Yeah, I think that's a, that's perfectly fine. I think that's a, strategy-wise, what you've said is fine. I think the, you know, if I were an investor looking at this as an investment opportunity, the thing that would really, you know, bother me is how do you rise above the noise and can you rise above the noise given that it is a very noisy market. And I don't know what questions you're getting from the people who are considering your investment offering, but that is the question that would be, for me, that would be the primary question. And you know, there are, how do you mitigate that question, right? People typically mitigate questions about like that by executing and showing results. That's just how you work.
Yeah. Great. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Ashwin Jain is having technical difficulties, so we're going to skip over to Avik Agarwal. Avik, you are up next. Avik, please unmute your line and tell us what you're working on.
Oh, yeah. My voice is audible?
Yes.
Yeah. My name is Avik Agarwal. Hello.
Please go ahead.
Hello. Yeah, my name is Avik Agarwal and I'm studying in first year BBA in Siliguri. And my like business plan is buy loads. We are in a kind of logistics service for the new business people, next slide please. Next slide. And the pain people are facing here is like they are having difficulty in choosing the right mode of transportation for mini loads, and even if they try the mini load, they don't know where to locate the transport, and after they locate them, they don't know what is the correct amount to pay, and they start bargaining. The local vendors, they lack trust. Proper invoice of our goods when we send is not we don't
so
receive
can
any
you,
kind of.
Can we start with the basics? What customer base are we talking about? Who is the customer?
And the customer will be SMEs, like small and medium enterprise. Business people who wants to send their goods from who wants to sell their goods to consumers and have responsibilities of delivering their goods to the consumers. Like if a customer comes in a shop and they ask for a good and they don't really want to take the responsibility of the transportation and they just give on the business entrepreneurs and they ask them to deliver their goods.
Okay. So drop ship, you're talking about drop ship logistics.
Yeah. It will be a mini load booking service which will provide booking for the mini load couriers to take mini loads of the people. Next
okay.
And we'll have all kind of new technology service like GPS, we'll keep transparent pricing. Basically, if we summarize the thing, it is a kind of Uber for logistics. Next slide, ma'am. Our company is like, as I said, it will be it will provide instant hassle-free bookings for mini load courier to, which provide mini load bookings for the mini load courier to carry mini loads as per their specific capacities and to the desired location.
And how many mini load carriers are there that fall within the, you know, supplier base for this? How many Have you done any analysis on that?
Yes, ma'am. How many mini-load service are there?
Yes, how many carriers like that are available in the market?
Like local vendors?
Yes.
There are approximately 100, 150 vendors are available in a small market like Siliguri in West Bengal. And if we accumulate or summarize the full state, it will be more than 1,000.
So you're saying there are enough of these small mini load carriers that if you create some sort of a marketplace to bring them all together and pair them up with the SMEs, there is an interesting business to do. And you sit in the middle of making these matches and you get paid on commission. It's basically the marketplace model, right?
Yes, ma'am. Next slide, ma'am.
Okay.
And my unique selling proposition will be, we'll provide instant booking service, we'll have GPS-enabled service, we'll try and deliver within the stipulated time.
What are you going to deliver? This is you are not starting a mini courier, right? Mini load courier.
No, I'll be in partners with the local vendors.
But then, why are you saying these GPS-enabled vehicles and all these things that you're expecting that all these carriers will be having this as a service, having these features?
I'll provide them with these services. They will partner with me. I'll provide them with this mobile handset or any GPS tracking system and with the software which is needed for them. And I'll connect all these drivers and I'll have a software for people to connect to this.
Who owns the vehicle? Who manages and vets the drivers?
I didn't get you, ma'am.
Who owns the vehicle? Is it the carrier, the mini load carrier, or you? Who owns the vehicle?
And the courier will be owned by the mini load vendors, the local vendors who are in the market. I'll just partner with them and I'll bridge up the gap that people have in finding them, or people face difficulty in booking them for carrying their mini loads.
No, I understand, but what I'm asking is if one of the requirements or one of the features of your network of carriers have these kinds of vehicles with all the trimmings of a GPS and all that stuff, the point is that most mini-load vehicles, mini-load carriers in India don't have that. So.
Yes.
Are you saying that you're going to require to partner with you that all these mini load carriers have these features in their vehicles? In which case, you have a very small market unless you are somehow retrofitting or upgrading these vehicles with all these facilities.
Ma'am, the local vendors with autos, they don't have this GPS enabled in their vehicles presently. So
right.
When they will get in touch with me, or I get in touch with them as my partners for this, I'll provide them with these services. I need to give them a mobile handset which has GPS enabled services, and I'll train them to how to use them, and in this way this thing will go on.
So Avik, here's what I think. You said that there are 150 mini load carriers like this in Siliguri alone. So do you have you talked to them? Have you figured out how many of them are willing to work with you if you put something like this together? If you were to pilot this in Siliguri, can you figure out what you get there? What kind of traction you get there from the local, sides of the equation?
I've talked to many of these vendors and they have the criteria that they suppose they earn 1,000 rupees a day, and if they get a business of more than 1,000, like 1,200 or 1,300, they will definitely like to work with me.
Okay. And now, what do you need to get this going? Get this started,
ma'am. For this, like beginning, I will be needing a software I need to get in touch with some software companies, or I'll take the bookings through calls and everything, and just GPS thing. For this, I need an investment of around 12 lakhs initially to begin the service.
So this is a kind of investment that, at this point where you are, given that you don't have any track record or anything, the only people who would be investing in you are going to be your friends and family. So can you pull together 12 lakhs from your friends and family to get this thing going?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Well, then, you know, start validating. Start getting a product together and you know, a critical mass on all sides of the equation and get it going then.
And as my business will start, I have a projected sales of with 30 autos, 30 vehicles, I will have a projected turnover of 148 lakhs. And in this way, I have calculated a profit for 3 years.
Yeah, I'm not sure if these assumptions are necessarily correct, because I think that, you know, there's a lot of details that are missing from this plan at this point. But that's okay. You should, you know, start piloting at a small scale, and you will learn what is involved in running this business.
Ma'am, the stages, like I have already, ma'am, the before slide. One slide before, ma'am. Ma'am, I have talked to various customers as their feedback for validation, and I have got a positive reply of around 95%. And my friends are ready to invest, as I have already mentioned above. Ma'am, now I'm presently, what I'm doing is I'm making a directory of all the commercial based vehicles who are ready to partner with me, and I'm talking to them, sir. How can I benefit them from, like, if they have a business with me, if they partner with me, like if they are earning 1,000 rupees today, how I can help them to make 1,300 rupees further?
Yep. That's exactly what you need to do is just work in your local ecosystem and get the model working. If you can get this model to work in Siliguri with the local, then you can expand to, you know, city by city you can expand. It's going to be, once you get the model and you understand the model, you understand the economics of the model, the unit economics of the model, which I don't believe you understand yet, because, you know, there's a lot of details that are missing from this. But as you start doing the business and getting this to work, you will learn you've got to validate by actually doing this one.
Yes, I'm now presently, we have a B-plan competition going on in India, as in Bangalore, and this is one of the plan which has got selected there among the 64 teams all over India.
Okay. And what do you get for that?
Ma'am, if I win the competition, there is a amount of 5 lakh rupees, and I think Google will sponsor some goodies, and our technical part will be seen by them, like our app, or their website.
I don't think you can count on Google to do your technology. That is not a viable technology strategy. The 5 lakh rupees will be very helpful. Then you only have to raise another 7 lakhs to get this kind of going. But don't count on Google to do your technology. That's not going to work.
Yeah. My question is, like, for marketing strategies, these SME companies, they are not so technically advanced. And if
Google AdWords and all that is going to be of no value with this crowd that you're talking about. And in Siliguri, you're going to have to, basically, this is going to be a very manual, very kind of going to them, and these 150 companies, you have to go talk to them and get them to engage with you.
Yeah,
the marketing strategy is a problem in terms of scaling something like this, because this is not a tech savvy crowd at all in India.
Okay, ma'am. And like, ma'am,
what I like about what you're doing, Avik, is that you're a very young college student, and you have come up with something that, you know, has a reasonable premise, and you're going to learn a lot. If you just build this business and just focus on how to build this business, and if you decide that you want to work with 1 million by 1 million, we'll be happy to help you do that. But my point is, you are you are have an incredibly rich learning opportunity ahead of you if you follow through on your interest in this business. So that, for to me, that counts for a lot.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. And I have one more question, ma'am.
Yeah.
Now for like investment thing, there are, I was just searching 2 to 3 days before, and I found there are 4 to 5 business established in a, it's not exactly the same in a similar manner, but they're in a particular place in Bangalore only. They're based on Bangalore and they're not so scaled up over India.
Mm-hmm.
So if I go for any investment companies to invest on me, so what shall...
No one is going to invest in your company right now, Abhik. Given where you are in terms of stage of development and validation, no one's going to invest in your company right now. So don't waste time trying to raise investment from professional sources at the moment. It's going to be a complete wastage of time. And you're going to be running up and down to Bangalore and beating on doors and nothing. You will get absolutely zero. Nothing will happen.
So whether there are competitions in Bangalore or not, I think I should start up in a small place like Siliguri where...
Don't worry about it. India is a very big country. If you can make Siliguri work profitably, your goal is not to raise huge amounts of financing. Your goal is to create a profitable, sustainable business and a model that actually is profitable from a unit economics point of view. If you can make that happen in Siliguri, then you go to another 5 towns in West Bengal and you know, then go to 50 towns in West Bengal and you go to, you know, the other states and you grow organically, it'll be fine. And if you actually are showing serious growth rates and everything and things are executing well, you will be able to attract financing as well. But now is not the time. Now is the time to just get your basic business in Siliguri working profitably in a sustainable, fundamentals-oriented way. That's what that's what I would do.
Thank you very much, ma'am. That was really profitable for me. I think I've learned from...
Good luck. I hope you move forward with, you know, figuring it out how to do this. And you're starting early. Starting entrepreneurship early in life is of huge value. You know, I started my first company when I was 24 years old. And actually not even, 23 years old. And as a result, in the last, you know, 20 plus years, I have learned a tremendous amount. And you will learn a tremendous amount. Look at what Mark Zuckerberg is doing at 31. He is running this, you know, one of the world's largest companies. And he's had a big time leg up over many people. All right, folks. I'm going to spend just a few minutes explaining to you how to take advantage of 1M1M if you decide that you want to work with us in the program. And before I go into that, my request to you is if you like what we are doing here, please refer serious entrepreneurs into 1M1M because that's really what we are looking for, is to work with serious high-quality entrepreneurs who are going to really put in the work required to build businesses. So everything we do, the resources are all at 1mby1m.com. It's a completely virtual program. We have a terrific blog where you'll learn a lot free of charge. Just so if you just follow along the blog, you'll learn a lot. And the Entrepreneur Journeys book series is completely available internationally on Amazon Kindle. Every single volume is available digitally, and it's a very, very low price point. Then you have tons of material, videos, FAQs, etc. on the website. So if you're evaluating the program, the best place to start is on our website. These roundtables happen every week. Today is the 276th roundtable. And take advantage of these. These are working sessions. We are here to work with you. That's the whole point and premise of our being here, week after week after week, and I hope you found today's session productive. Make sure you register to pitch or to attend, and Maureen will be in touch with you with the instructions on what you need to do to prepare, etc. Then we also have a premium program where we offer extensive methodology guidance. We have a great curriculum which is essentially taught by over 600 successful entrepreneurs, and we've brought them on, captured their lessons from the trenches and et cetera, and packaged it up into a tremendously powerful body of learning material. And that's that learning you do on your own time. We also have asynchronous, that's the asynchronous part of the learning. The synchronous part of the learning is these kinds of roundtables, and we have, you know, we do the strategy consulting, mentoring, consulting, whatever you call it, the working together in these kinds of roundtables, and we have many roundtables in the premium program. And we help you with business development, whether it's introductions to customers, channel partners, investors, media analysts, all of that is part of the $1,000 annual membership fee premium program. So, you know, dig around on the website, look at the case studies of our successes, the Million Dollar Club, look at the ROI equation, look at the one-on-one and self-assessment, the kinds of questions that you need to answer, and, you know, decide for yourself whether this program is for you or not. There's a ton of material on what to expect from the premium program. There's a ton of video FAQs. If you decide that you like what we do and if you'd like the kind of coaching and mentoring we offer, you're very welcome to join the program, and we will work with you shoulder to shoulder continuously through your membership in the program. Now, our methodology is lean, capital efficient, bootstrap startups. Even if you raise money, you're going to have to bootstrap the early stages, and that's just the reality of the market. Investors are looking for validated businesses. That's why we don't want you to go beating on investors' doors without validation first, and that's a total wastage of time. If you go do that, it's a complete wastage of time. So, you know, we will provide you with tons of material and tons of guidance, but at the end of the day, you are going to be doing the work and you know, making the progress. So if you follow the methodology, we are pretty confident at this point that we can help you move forward and make progress, because we have done that with a lot of entrepreneurs, and we have pretty much, you know, a solid amount of experience at this point, 5 years into the program, of helping people be successful. So, you know, decide for yourself. This program is not for everybody. If you're not comfortable with online learning, do not join the program. You're not going to be able to leverage the program, because it is an online program. It is virtual learning and so forth. So it's just, you have to self-select yourself whether this is the right program for you or not. We also have an affiliate program where we partner with other organizations that are trying to do entrepreneurship development, and we are happy to partner with you if that's what you're doing. Upcoming free roundtables pretty much every Thursday until the end of October. Vision India 2020 is the 13th book from the 1M1M program. It has $45 billion ideas, and you're welcome to take any of them and execute. You can morph them, copy, steal, borrow, morph whatever you want. The 1M1M Incubator in a Box is our platform that we use with corporations, governments, and so forth to run incubation programs on their behalf and in partnership with them. A bunch of the recent Entrepreneur Journeys books are Billion Dollar Unicorns, Carnival in the Cloud, Bootstrapping with a Paycheck, From E-commerce to Web 3.0. And that's it. You know, if you want to ask questions, we have time to, a little bit of time to discuss further. So you can either call in or you can ask questions in public chat, and we will be happy to answer. Anybody? By the way, you can also introduce yourself. This is a very good time to network a bit and tell us who you are, where you're joining from, what your issues are, what your projects are, what kind of project are you working on. While you're doing that, let me introduce you to Irina Patterson. If you have questions about the 1M1M program and you would like to talk to somebody, Irina Patterson is the person to call. She would prefer that you send her an email first, because a lot of things she can just tackle by email, and then if necessary, she'll get on the phone with you. Maureen is providing a question from Quora that is popular this week. What is the best way to get venture capitalist or angel attention besides networking? So I answered this question on Quora, and I'll just share the answer that I gave on Quora. The best way is to generate PR in credible circles so that they hear about your achievements from someone and call you. So inbound is better than outbound is the bottom line message. We often hear from entrepreneurs that they get calls because we've covered them on our blog. Well, our blog has a big VC angel readership, so that's an example of a credible circle. There are many others, and they don't have to be TechCrunch, which only covers funding news. So, you know, if you, we have a lot of credibility in this circle. So, you know, if we write about you, there's a good likelihood that you will catch somebody's attention. And that's just, you know, one way to get attention from people whose attention you're trying to catch. By the way, don't forget, customers' attention is the most important attention. And you should pay a lot of attention to customers' attention as opposed to investors' attention. Tammy Hankins is sending me a private message. Tammy, I'm just going to read it out because we're right now doing a public roundtable. So I'd rather you send me public messages. So send messages to all participants. The message that Tammy is sending me is thanks for the presentation. At this time, I'm just evaluating the program. I may have some entrepreneurs to forward to your next meeting, okay? That's great. And Tammy, where are you? Where are you calling from? And what organization do you represent? Maureen is providing another question from Cora. Meanwhile, what are some common misconceptions of becoming an entrepreneur? Well, my answer to that question is people believe entrepreneurship equals funding. Wrong. Entrepreneurship equals customers plus revenues plus profits. Funding is optional. So, folks, definitely chime in with your questions and your, you know, issues. We're just providing you with some pointers to some questions we are getting from Cora in, you know, recently and have answered so that you can tap into that that material. But I'm most curious about what you are doing and what you're working on. Well, Abhik Agarwal is asking, well, ma'am, what are the criteria panel look for when I'll be pitching near them in the summit of 200 people? Are you, Abhik Agarwal, are you asking about your business plan competition? If that's what you're asking, I would go to the self-assessment on our website. On the 1 million by 1 million website, there is a 1M1M self-assessment. And those are the kinds of questions that people are trying to answer. You know, investors are trying to answer. People who are evaluating the viability of your business are trying to answer. So take your idea through those questions and try to assess by yourself. Tammy Hankins is saying, she's in Portland, Oregon, in industrial sustainability solutions consulting company on capital construction, risk management, sustainability strategies, interested in new innovations. All right. Sriharsha Reddy, Madi Reddy, says it's a first session and very informative. That's great. Very happy to hear that. So, folks, it's 9:33 a.m. We try to finish this call by 9:30. So we are 3 minutes over, so I'd like to adjourn for today, and we will be back here and next week at same time, same place, 8 a.m. Pacific time. Whichever time zone you're on, please adjust to that time, and we will continue this working session. Remember, this is a working session. We are here to work together with you. Bye-bye, everybody. Thank you very much for coming.